are so confused, but you are people who looked into the pamphlet very nicely and took note of the correct time. This evening, we are in continuation with yesterday's talk. This is the first time the MOSAIC is hosting a two-lecture comments. We thought it'd be better to have it on a separate day. And this is the first pilot that we're trying to have, having a lecture on the same day and a series of lectures, because one is not enough. And tomorrow evening, we have a cultural evening at the amphitheater. So this evening's lecture will be delivered to us by Dr. Malem Ningthouja. He's going to speak on Indian nation, rebels, and history, the paradox of nationhood in certain conflict areas in Northeast. I would like to introduce for the chair of this evening session, Dr. Rocky Riley, if he can come over and sit here in the panel. He's a consultant for the Ministry of Social Justice and Empowerment. If at all one among the MOSAIC knows this so well, it is Rocky himself. He has been here since his BA, MPhil, and MA to MPhil and PhD. So you can count the number of years he's here. So if this was US, he has got a green card. So thank you so much, Rocky, for joining us as a chair. Slight introduction to the speaker. Briefly, this evening's speaker, Dr. Malem Ningthouja, whose full name is Ningthoujam Malem Nganba Meite, so if you want to take note of it. He graduated from Delhi University, Hindu College, and he continued his MA, MPhil, and PhD from DU. So we have two people who are completely a product of DU and TISS this evening session. From the Department of History, and he was a fellow at the Indian Institute of Advanced Study in Shimla, Marshall. His MPhil, MPhil and PhD has a very interesting title. His MPhil was on the Manipur nationalism, which was later converted into a book. And also his PhD thesis was on diametric nationalism, which was also again made into a book. And the third book that he published is one of the most exhaustive work on AFSPA, entitled India's War on Democracy, the Debate on AFSPA, 1958. So he has three most popular books. He also has a lot of chapters written in various books, and also a lot of publishings done in various newspapers, and has extensively written, especially in terms of state and nation. And I think there is no right person more than him than to be speaking this evening. Without much ado, I would like to invite the MOSAIC coordinator, where is he? You can bring the TISS shawl and we have a customary. Rocky can. Briefly goes like this. We have introductory remark from the chairman, and then followed by the speaker speaking on the topic, after which is a concluding remark, and then Q&A followed. So I give the time for the chairperson to see.
Good evening, everyone, once again, and welcome to TISS MOSAIC Lecture 2017. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity to chair the session, even though I don't have any experience. Nevertheless, my basic role is just to keep a time. Today's lecture is going to be delivered by none other than Dr. Malem Ningthouja, who has a huge field experience, as well as an established academician. As Rodriguez mentioned, he'll be delivering his lecture on Indian state, rebels and history, paradox of nationhood in certain conflict areas in Northeast, which I think is very relevant for a MOSAIC festival to deliberate upon. Before I invite, I would like to make a few observations in regards to Northeast. The region called Northeast India in the past 3 to 4 centuries has witnessed an overwhelming transformation brought in by the influence of Bengal and followed by the British colonial rule. Along these processes, the changes involved in one community ought to raise a special reference to princely state, and land plays an important role here in defining the present and future. The ethnic communities which left themselves in fending their ancestral lands, customs, traditions and culture. Demands for sovereignty is an initial assertion from ethnic communities of Northeast India. As consciousness gains foothold, the resistance took the route of movement for nationalism against the nation-state. Nationalism movements are organic in nature. Over the decades, the nationalism movement in its bid for sovereignty has died down and reduced to autonomy of demand under the ambit of the nation-state. This has underpinning of the context that exists among various ethnic communities where the state has laid a ground for political economy, privatization of land, development, and etc. The outcome to this resolved into an expression of various ethno-nationalisms. The ethno-nationalisms operates at the power relations between ethnic communities. The non-existence of collective nationalism from ethnic communities can be read in two ways. The first one being that the state divisive politics nurture the growth of ethno-nationalisms, and the other being the expression of ethno-nationalism by resorting to state mechanism in making a claim against neighboring ethnic communities. These forms of nationalisms operating at the level of nation-state and taking recourse in expressing ethno-nationalism using state apparatus are the reality that frames the discourse of assertions among ethnic communities. The formation of creation of eight states in Northeast has in no way diluted the feelings of nationalism among various ethnic communities. Rather, it has introduced the politics of territoriality. Hence, one can see even to this day various political demands stemming both from insurgent groups and civil society in the Northeastern states with greater frequency and intensity. It is true that historically, the region has witnessed high level of violence, particularly armed insurrections. Political violence too has been directed in equal measure against different ethnic groups and the authorities, stemming mostly from ethnic and state subjugation. To address this, the government of India has adopted various approaches in dealing with the so-called region notice. They are like the cultural paradigms, the security paradigms, the political paradigms, and development paradigms as the mantra of all solutions. On the other hand, within the regions, for decades, there has been institutionalized operations, exclusions, and denials of rights by the dominant communities against the minority. Their voices and lived movements are subsumed within the dominant power structure. The dominant perspective, especially elite's perspective within, legitimizes all the decision making, be it political, social, or economical. So, can we explore and engage the agent-driven politics of dominant and subordinate social category in the context of Northeast while unraveling the politics of nationalisms? And how unequal power relations of various communities lead to social unrest, development disparity, hostility and structural inequality while asserting and articulating for nationhood. So in the context of Northeast, ignoring the multifaceted of marginality, structural inequality and dynamics of power relation within the state and the region would amount to the denial of ethnic minorities' existence and their nationalisms. Against this background, the theoretical positions of Bhavantara de Santos that cultural diversity and epistemological diversity are reciprocally independent finds its relevance in the context of Northeast. He posits that exclusions, oppressions, and discrimination it produces have not only economic, social, and political dimension, but also cultural and epistemological ones. I hope the speaker will unravel and present the ongoing diametrical nationalisms with reference to Mesos, Nagas, Kukis, Maitis, Garos, Boros, and so on. With this note, may I invite Dr. Malem Ningthouja to deliver his speech.
Thanks to MOSAIC for inviting me. Perhaps you have invited the most confused man in the world to speak. There's nothing left for me to speak, in fact. What I will do is, I will just try to put in a loose framework in the most simple language by not taking along the English line. Sometimes we are moved by technical terms and the language that we are accustomed to, and the message hardly reaches to the people across the region. So I will try to summarize everything and in around 20 minutes, and then I will be more interested in the interactive session. To begin with, this confused man lived in a very confused region called Manipur, where there are at least three or four nationalisms coexisting. Right? You have the Indian nationalisms and its agents, and people who subscribe to the idea of Indian nations. Then there are large sections of the population having strong claims over the territorial area where the Nagaland is about to be established. And so then you have Naga nationalisms. Then there is Kuki nationalisms forced into something called Zarendon or something like Zogam, Joram, whatever it is. And there is Manipur nationalism, sometimes called the Kamaibang agenda or whatever. So you have the situations in a place like a mosaic, same as the mosaic, where people subscribing to different nationalisms are coexisting, confronting, negotiating, coordinating. So there is elements of coordination and conflict also at various levels. What I will try to do is to define the nation from a purely ideological perspective, and then do a little bit of make use of this concept as a yardstick to measure the paradoxes of the nations. And then I will focus predominantly on the Indian state, its idea of Indian nationhood, and how it has been trying to what you call trickle down this idea, to diffuse this idea, and how it has been operating. And while doing that, I will also try to point out the political economy of the Indian nationalism, which has been crafted, designed, and then rigorously circulated by the Indian state, which are reflected in various forms of policy makings, as he pointed out, tailored and state policies. That's something that I want to end. I'll try to focus briefly on how some of the forces that articulate particular nationalisms either continue to resist or have just scaled down their resistance due to negotiations, and where there are certainly negotiations going on. So like we have a very complex situation. But to see holistically as notice as a whole would be quite an injustice, because we don't have enough time to focus on every aspect, ranging from Garo to Boro to the Ahomia nationalism, so whatever it is, and the incipient forms of resistance centered on the idea of indigeneity, which is looming now in Arunachal Pradesh and Chirap, yes, and all that we do. What I would try to say is, like, you know, we have the United Nations, which give recognitions to established states, you know, where certain principles from the Westphalian Peace of Westphalian model, like 1648, is being incorporated, where they try to define the sovereignty of the established states and then identify it almost equally with nations and territoriality. That's how India got recognition after 1947 in the United States, where people who are rebelling against the Indian state are still not being included into the list of, or say, Committee of Nations. Except NSNIN, who's got some kind of recognition at the level of the UNPO, sometimes in the 1930s, but others are not still. My point would be to give questions mark to, like, you know, many in India thinks that India is a nation, but then if you asked that what really constitutes Indian nation that I think many would be at a loss to respond to. But then the general perception is that the nation is invincible and inviolable, right? It must have a shape and size. That is the priority of every nation. So you have some portions of Kashmir, which according to some report on mapping, you know, they don't have that portion, but if you publish that in India, then you'll ban. So you have a full figure of the human figure without any fractures. But in reality, the shape and size that we see on maps are highly elusive, and this only represent certain kinds of symbolic representations, cartographed and crafted, designed and permanently circulated by the Indian state. And it is in this attempt to convert this imagined nation into, you know, visible and tangible forms on the ground that there are series of carrot and iron policies. So at the levels of policies, you have reproduction of maps, reproduction of reports, constructions of historiography, and polemical literatures defending this very imagined fictions of the Indian nationhood. And same thing would be mimicked or say copied by the other fighting forces for Nagaland and then the Zalengam or whatever it is. Recently, the Kuki national organizations have come up with the idea of Manase, which have incorporated everybody within the Kuki nation, including Zalayongs and all. Unfortunately, they have left out Tangus, thinking that Tangus are enemies of the Kukis. So otherwise, these are all, you know, fictional claims going on through crafting of this idea of nations, which are being depicted in visible and tangible forms. And the question is whether this really exists on the ground. It's a big question, and my book exactly focuses on those aspects. Having said this, what I would like to inform the crowd over here is, like, you know, let me trace the historical backgrounds of the formations in chronological order. As a student of history, we have this habit of reproducing facts and figures, and it rarely helps. So, like, but I strongly argue that India is not a nation. And this has been my position, it's not a nation. It could be a political community, but there is element of colonialism being incorporated by the Indian state while it is trying to, you know, create the Indian, the geographical area as a safe haven of capitalist exploitations and all forms of dominations by the peoples who have constituted the Indian state. And this also brings into another ideological question on what is the state. And we believe that the state that we exist now is an instrument of class operations by the ruling class. That has been our ideological point and standpoint, political standpoint. Based on that, what we said is that India's territorial making has been an ongoing process from mid-1940s. Thing is, after independence, India wanted to inherit everything that the British had possessed. And they want to create a geographical space by the Indian ruling class, by merging, by bringing into its fold different areas which have never been part of India. In the sense, like, never part of British India. So so India, which we see today, is an expansion of the ruling class, which is a form political routine, political and economic routine, routine in the then British India. And these expansions took place both at different levels in terms of negotiations and use of forces. So, like, what we show today as India is, you know, a merging of the different regions comprising British India, princely states, tribal regions which were recognized as excluded areas in 1935, and then colonial regions and enclaves. So, to give you an example, I'll say that Northeast regions becomes a very important place, considered to be a very important place by the Indian state, and they don't want to lose it at any cost. If one would go through the debates and discussions in the Constituent Assembly, then there are volumes of reports and recordings and statements on the Northeast. They don't want the Northeast to be gone away, and they want it to be part of India. But the irony is that in 1940s, late 40s, many of them are quite unaware of the Northeast. Many of them have never visited these regions. Many of them have not studied these regions. The only thing is that these capitalists, these rulers, and these political elites, you know, in order to promote your economic and political interests, they need a geographical space to thrive on. And what they perceived about the Northeast was that it's a volatile area, it has to be kept within India. And then it should be a place where where they would be able to create a buffer region vis-à-vis the external invasions or whatever, and then they need the resource out there, and they need the peoples there to defend and guard the imagined Indian nationhood, so and so forth. So like it is, the merging of Northeastern region is not a response, or say a response from below, but it was something already pre-designed and designed by the Indian states. Then you have like the controversial manner in which Kashmir became part of India in 1947 and 48, and the struggle still goes on now. And Chandrapur was seceded to India from the French occupation in 1949-50. Then Andaman Nicobar Islands from the Japanese and the British control in 1950. Then you have other establishment of de facto control at the de facto rules over Yanam, Mahe, Pondicherry, and Karaikal and all. And in 1960, Goa and Daman and Diu was taken over from Portuguese control. And very interestingly, like if you read Constitution of India Article 1, it has the provisions of annexation, but not the provisions of right to succession. So you already have a fixed idea of constitutionality and fixed everything and things that these are the weak spots where we have to occupy at any cost. Areas should not be that loose from the control of the Indian state. So it's something, purely controlled by Indian state. Again, in addition to what that have been taken over, they also have to increasingly penetrate to other neighboring regions, weaker regions, where sphere of influence of India's capital systems has to have a big stakeholder. So like you have something called like, in China, Mekmon Bank have to be fixed in 1948. They don't know exactly where the Mekmon line actually locates, and the controversy still existed, and it culminated to war in 1962. Again, in 1947, British mission in Lhasa became Indian mission. And when the trade team from Tibet visited New Delhi in 1948 for trade agreement, they said that until and unless Tibet recognized India as an inheritor of the British tradition obligations in Tibet, then there won't be any trade agreement. So finally, it compelled the Tibet to sign this trade agreement in 1948. And Sikkim becomes Indian protectorate by intervening into the local uprisings in 1949. Since then, the protectorate was established strongly firmly until annexation of Sikkim in 1975. Then you have in Bhutan, where the foreign affairs of Bhutan has to be controlled by the Indian state from 1949 onward on the basis of the treaty. And then in Myanmar, it's a very dialectical and dynamic situation. But finally, they negotiated in 1953 about 1,000 square kilometers controversial area of Manipur was finally ceded away to Burma so that India had a free claim over Andaman and Nicobar Islands, the region which was in the Anglo-Indian and Anglo-British dominance areas. But again, Nepal, 1940, the Treaty of Friendship could not really subjected Nepal to the dictatorial role of the Indian states. What I have been giving all this example is that the map that you see is not a permanent entity, primordial entity, gifted by God or gifted from a very ancient phenomena. This is a very recent phenomena. It's aggression, and aggression is still going on. The border scheme is along to the Burma border lines and the Bangladesh border line, and the Arunachal Pradesh border line has been still on. So this is not something invincible. It's a state and a geography that is emerging. And the evolution of this territory has indulged in lots of violations. At the same time, there are elements of co-option with local ruling elites, no doubt. But there are also elements of separations and elements of occupations, etc. What I am saying is, without understanding capitalism and how it really works, we will be able to fully understand the nature of Indian nationalisms. I am not talking about the lay persons who have blindly or uncritically subscribed to the idea of nationhood being articulated by the Indian state. But my focus is on the manner how the ruling elites have crafted this idea of Indian nationhood and how it is being endorsed to adopting very, very aggressive and vicious cycles of politics. Now, I'm saying that India has been adopting an expansive discourse. This is going to be seen now in the Lugis policy, which has been termed as Aegis policy, starting from 1960s. And we are going to notice lots of fundamental sins in terms of, you know, like economic underdevelopment at a very full swing. I won't be focusing into that, but if there's any questions from the crowd, then well, we can address to that. So what the phenomenon in the North is like expansionist calls for what? Occupation of territory, establishment of governance, exploitation of natural resources, and monopoly market, where they also installed the big military bastions in order to expand India's commercial relations with the neighboring Southeast Asian countries. And all this involves what? Control of knowledge systems, and this includes, among others, the idea of nationhood that has been rigorously diffused through different channels, starting from, you know, designing your education curriculum to all kind of funding of research for various fields and etc. and all the advertising schemes, etc. So the control of knowledge is something that has been rigorously carried out. So the propaganda of nationhood and the discourse of order and terrorism. Interestingly, India has fitted all these occupied territories within the domesticity. And domesticity has a kind of in international legitimacy that you don't see the resistance by the Mijo people, resistance by the Nagas in Manipur, or wherever, as in freedom struggle. They are being seen simply as a law order problem by quote-unquote misguided peoples, right? So the Nagas were not, and NNC was never seen as a revolutionary force in 1940s, 50s, 60s. So what you will see in the parliament debate is talking all about what is being called Naga hostile, as if hostile is an aberrative phenomena, right? So you only have to tame the hostiles, or either if they're not allowed, then this disobedient civilians who are challenging the mighty Indian Empire has to be crushed out by any means. So like in 1966, you have aerial bombings and all forms of atrocities being superimposed on the Mizo liberation movement initiated by the Mizo National Front. And then what happened, very interestingly, there is a process of co-options with the local ruling elites. And normally people call them as the puppets of the systems, like funding of local elites. And these elites becomes what they are what? Critically, they either fight elections and win elections, and they depend on the Indian state for economic and political power. And you have created a layer of elite levels of bureaucrats and judges and police officers who would subscribe to the Indian ideology primarily for these vested, economic motives. The point is like, you know, under capitalist system, what happened is like, you must be, you know, you all are in advanced stage of learning, so I don't think I should be defining capitalism. But I have been saying that, well, under capitalism, private ownership of the means of production is normed, and all social and political relations are governed by the system of commodity exchange for profit and agenda, and this has broken down everything to that level. And interestingly, in northeastern regions, the capitalist structure in northeastern region is something where you don't really see the local the growth of local capitalist forces who would engage in, you know, investment in the variable and constant capitals. They will not do that. Instead, the forms of accumulation of wealth is rested in misappropriation of rent provided by the state. They call it central grants, but I call it rent. India is giving rent to the northern regions for occupying these regions because these regions has to be pacified. This has been dubbed as central grants or special plan assistance or whatever, but in reality it's a form of rent. And what the local elites and the puppets really does is, you know, they fight among themselves in order to take a big share out of this rent. And this is the primary forms of accumulation of wealth. They loot it, they covered it in the name of community. And this is where the paradox of nationalism would actually rise in long term. So like the struggles between NSC and IM and the Manipuri nationalist forces are also partly on about how much territorial areas should come under their purview, because none of these revolutionary, so-called revolutionary forces have any proper economic and political programs. They rely on Indian money for fight for resistance against Indian states. that's the weakest point of the revolutionary forces. And in this accumulation process, gradually social stratifications along class lines takes place. This happens with the rank and files of almost all the internal organizations. I can't prove it, but I know it. The propensity to raise the process of militarization, policing, and repression. So it's not something like that the Indian security forces just came and occupied these regions. They are using the local resources, local people for armed separations. Like in the Naga area, some of you must have in the 1950s and 60s, when there was escalations of counter-terrorism, so-called counter-terrorism, it was DVD who was actively various volunteer forces or whatever, recruited from among the Nagas. And if I have to give you a lengthy lecture on how the intelligence and the military forces operated in a very, you know, concealed manner, it will be a totally different chapter and it will take lots of time. But as a scholar and as an academic, I have gone into that and I know how it really happens. But I will be touching here. Along with that, there are proxy wars at various levels, at the levels of political parties, at the levels of communities, etc., etc. So like the occupations of the regions and the attempt to perpetuate the neoliberal systems under the command of Indian ruling class involves all these phenomena. And its impact is manifold. Like you have suppression of freedom and suspension of democratic rights and underdevelopment, particularly like, you know, neglect of the primary and secondary sectors. Whatever development infrastructure you saw around is something called cosmetic packages. Just, you know, an ugly woman with a bad stomach having lots of ears on the face, you want to cover up that face and use the cosmetics just to show that it's bright and beautiful. But in reality, when the cosmetic got washed out, then everything becomes revealed. So the bad symptoms are being covered up through very attractive cosmetic packages to show to the world that you are doing something very great, but unfortunately, underdevelopment has crept in. And the best examples of underdevelopment is that many of you are here today in this for higher education. Why don't you have that acknowledged? Okay? So like inequality and economic injustice have been taking place. Of late, in the name of Lucas policy, they are destroying agricultural land, they are destroying ecological harmony and constructing dams, office buildings, sports university is coming up by destroying agricultural land. And so like normally, you know, there is no proportionate development. So the basic rules of capitalism, that is unequal development of nations, really persist, and Northeast becomes a hub of the consumers of the goods manufactured outside the regions. And along with that, there is a strong destruction of ecological harmony, and then demographic shifting. There is, you know, many are migrated outside the region, whereas many from mainland India, many monopolies and labors and other exploitative forces are now gradually penetrating. So you would see heavy militarization and all forms of immigration from outside, which have gradually shifted the demographic profiles and the everything. So we have bad symptoms along with the changes being brought about by the Indian state. And what I am trying to say is, like, you know, while these things take place throughout this period from 1947 to this date, there are concurrent community formations at various levels. And these community formations are reflected in various ways of, like, imagining nations in their own perspectives. And these feelings have posed a threat to the predominant forms of nationalism articulated by the Indian state. And physically, these are reflected in various forms of struggles for autonomy within the constitution of India or for direct liberations from the Indian Union. And that's the phenomenon. And this is not something very new. And among the Nagas, it primarily started in I'm talking about the 20th century. I'm not talking about the 19th century resistance against the colonial rule. I'm talking about the evolutions of the Naga Club from 1929, development of, you know, Naga Hills District Council, Naga National Council, etc., and so on, that has been continuing till today. I mean, even Manipur, you know, it has got its own constitution adopted in 1947, and then for responsible government was established in 1948. But India arbitrarily and without following any legal norms colluded with the prince and then annexed Manipur in 1947. Sorry, 49. And same thing happens with this thing. So right after the end of Second World War and when the Indian Independence Act was about to pass, many communities have already started awakening. And this awakening was reflected in various forms of assertions of nationalisms of various kinds, which was primarily conceived by the elite sections, and then it got materialized into forming different organizations, and this organization spearheaded different forms of democratic or say constitutional demands, and along with that there are also sections which have carried out armed resistance. So this is not something new, and this is not something ahistorical, but then it operates in a situation, in a historical juncture, where the Indian state has also rigorously trying to impose its very idea of nationhood in a very diabolical and, you know, in a very repressive manner. I am not discussing about AFSPA and state terrorism at this point of time. I think, continue for another 10 minutes. But the problems of nationhood that I'm trying to say is that nation, as I understand, it should be defined, or it's been defined in this manner. A nation, according to me, is a historically evolved, stable community formed on the basis of common language, territory, economic livelihood, and psychological makeup manifested in cultural way of life. This was the definition being accepted by the Bolsheviks in 1919. After the end of Second World War, it becomes part of the policy of the Soviet policy in the then Soviet Russia. And unfortunately, you know, based on this definition, India is not a nation. At the same time, Manipur is not a nation. It is a political community constituted by the elites on the basis of certain negotiations and bargaining. Let me give you an example. So the Manipur, we have many communities. Yes, there are lingua franca, Manipuri. But it does not mean that this is the mother tongue of all the communities. No. And in a situation where underdevelopment is taking place, and where tribalisms have not been broken down, it's unimaginative to feel that Manipur is a nation. We still lack the psychological unity now. So, like, if you talk about MIT, yeah, we can say that it's a nation. But if we have to look at territoriality, you raise territorial nationalisms being in the process of attempt to diffuse this idea, but still, it is not acceptable to many who think it otherwise. The problem is when the Manipur nationalism is being polemically articulated, you raise elements of originalisms and ethnicisms being incorporated into it, and blindly, the Indian puppet regimes incorporated the cultural symbols and elements and interests of certain restive forces, because in democracy, under Indian systems, it's the majority that carries the voice, right? So like, well, it is a minority rule, but apparently in face value, it's the in terms of symbols and in terms of the other facilities, the apparently seems to be favoring the so-called dominant community, so others are left out. And this is primarily one of the reasons why common economic cohesion and psychological makeup is missing. But the level in 1947, as I believe, I have all the documents, including the minutes of the meeting of the constitution-making body held in 1947, then my conclusion is that it's a political community. And among the Nagas, you know, see, very interestingly, all these nationalist forces write their own unique history. I sometimes say that the uniqueness of the unique history is that there is a process to write unique history. That's the only uniqueness. So it's primarily motivated by the polemical interest, and whatever we saw is not historiographically correct from the scientific point of view. These are not based on historical materialisms or any proper studies of history, rather these are political history constructed with a political agenda by the nationalist forces. These are nationalist twisted polemical histories. So you may be having a unique history of the Nagas, but in reality, Nagas have been, not been formed into a nation. So we can still discuss on this. And same thing applies with the whole idea of Zarendam. Among the cookies, that's the fundamental questions that I raised to Uncle Bill Hawkins when I met him and said that, where is the cookie nation? Well, you have cookie people, but you have included everything into it. Very interestingly, even in the, you know, the Nagas are in the process of making into a stable community and they want to establish a state of their own, that's true. But to call it as a nation would be wrong. The presumption is that, you know, many subscribe to the definition of nations that I have just mentioned. And many want to, the point is, they subscribe to that definitions, but they want they want to convert it into reality, and in the process, they are projecting it as a reality. So that's where the paradox lies. Somebody says Naga doesn't exist in Manipur, then I said, who thrown the stones at this Naipati? Are they Naga or somebody else? They said, you know, like so. So recognizance or de-recognition is a different issue, but in reality, people exist. But how do you define it? Your depends. The point is, like when you say a nation, then it's very easy to identify who the national enemy is. That's the whole agenda of the cookie quit notice served in 1992, and there has been enough blood blast from 1992 to 1996. So like it involves like, you know, constructions of the whole idea of insiders and outsiders. So there is a tendency of exclusiveness and inclusiveness. Some want the eyeball to be with the Naga, and some want the eyeballs to be with cookies, and both beat up the eyeballs saying eyeballs are at a loss of like, where is their identity? The eyeballs in the confused state. Right? This happens with primarily with the old cookies. Right, whether they should be identified as a Naga, whether they should remain as an isolated identity, or whether they should be with the Naga, or whether they should be simply with the in India. There's lots of confusions. But from a technical point of view, they took either side in different ways. That's a different history. So you have several groups of people living together in a territory or in the adjoining areas who are now defined differently by different people based on particular notions of nations. And at the same time, there is a confused state where, you know, in the same locality, there are people who subscribe to Manipur nationalism, or say there are people who subscribe to Indian nationalism. And there will be somebody who is subscribing to. So you can't really fix the boundary of the national components, in fact, although the attempt has been there. That's the situation, and it's a very complex situation. And this loyalty is also shifting depending upon time and situation. So there are only paradoxes that we see, we exist, but the reality is that in the name of nations, there has been lots of progress. Had there been no insurgency, I don't think that the government of India would have been given this much of attention in terms of cosmetic services and service delivery. Nowadays, you know, like some of the UPSC aspirants are given a good amount of money if they would clear prelims. That's a big job, right, you know, like that you have to write this exam because they have to unsubscribably prescribe to the books published by the UGC and other books, you know, that you have to become the parent, that simply repeating what the government wants you to speak. So you're not allowing enough time to critically think. What India have forgotten is that, you know, in Boxer Rebellion and all, in the early Chinese Revolution, it was the civil servant aspirants who never get through that they form their own revolutionary forces and start fighting. You cannot cover up the systems of exploitations and discriminations on the basis of recruiting more people to the UPSC. That's quite unfair. So, like, let me conclude by saying that neither India, nor Kangri Park, nor Nagaland, nor Jalangam are nations. These are fictions articulated by different nationalist forces. And predominantly India has done lots of damages and injustice in the name of upholding Indian nations. And the systems of injustice and violence have been copied by many of our nationalist forces. And most of these nationalist forces who rebel against the Indian states, instead of looking revolution from purely scientific perspectives have indulged in communalizing the politics, and it has created lots of societal attacks amongst one another, which have led to genocidal impacts among the so-called indigenous peoples. And so there is an overall injustice, because everybody subscribes to this whole neoliberal idea, and they all are in a very societal mode, and it's the peoples who are suffering. But I don't say that nationalism is bad, but I am saying that the protagonists of these nationalisms do not have revolutionary visions. This is where the movements have failed. This is where even resistance against us have failed. So we are living in a conjunctural situation where critical thinking of the emergent youth is very much required. We have to seek for a brighter future, a future where development takes place, a future where we do not compromise ecological harmony, a future where sustainable development takes place, a system and a situation where we are not commanded by the big market forces and finance intrusions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Malem. He has covered a wide range of issues, starting from the very problematizing the very notion of nations, and he has also traced in the historical trends to give him the few visions of the future. He has covered up the political economy of internationalisms, and as I said, has beautifully unraveled the historical trends in nationalism and separation by the Indian states, and also he has also define the very notions of the nations. So without wasting further time, I will now open the floor for the questions. And I would like to request the audience that please, when you ask a question, be brief and precise. Now the floor is open.
Good evening. I would like to ask, how does the idea of neoliberalism harming the public at large? Could you please throw some light on that?
What?
How does the idea, how does neoliberalism causing suffering of people?
Your definition of neoliberalism or?
Could you please?
Can we take 2-3 questions at a time, and then the speaker can answer it? Yeah, please.
Sir, the definition of the definition of concept of nationalism which you told us, the one by the Bolsheviks, don't you think it is too monotonous?
Do you have any more questions?
Now, there's this statement which you said that, you know, neither India or Nagaland or any other are nations. You know, these are not nations. So, and but then you said, you know, they are constantly, these are, the nationalism in the Northeast have been constantly attacked by the, by India. So, what is this India you are talking about? Is it a nation or is this some abstract identity? Because in the initially you said, you know, neither India or Nagaland are nations, but, you know, then he said, you know, but the idea of the India has constantly attacked the nationalisms in the Northeast. So what is this India you're talking about?
Can we take one last question and let the speaker answer?
Thank you for the fascinating presentation. I have two questions. One is regarding the Constitution of India. Well, if one takes a critical look at Indian Constitution, do you think that, for instance, you know, we have fundamental rights, and as you rightly pointed out, that, you know, there are also exceptions within fundamental rights. For instance, when you compare fundamental rights within India, you know, there are you know, various chapters, but fundamental rights are squeezed, you know, compared to other liberal constitution, where, for instance, US Bill of Rights is complete constitution. And here you have very small portion fixed for fundamental rights. And within that fundamental rights, there are exceptions made. And when it comes to regions like Northeast, you know, you have where, for instance, Armed Forces Special Powers Act is an emergency provision, which was which has its legacy in colonial times, and which remains an emergency. There's also a need of you know, taking a more regional approach to Northeast. When I'm saying regional approach, I'm saying that, you know, for instance, you know, at one level you can say that, you know, now state is talking about Northeast as a gateway, which yesterday we were having a discussion here. But, you know, imagination of Northeast in region, as a region in itself, you know, as a region which existed much, much before the idea of India came into existence. So that approach, do you think that will sort of, you know, give us possibilities of reimagining Northeast as
I cannot understand your first question properly. It was more, I thought it was more of a comment, so at least for the
question.
No. Sure. Yes,
no,
yeah,
it was sort of an observation when I was saying that, you know, Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which is, you know, based on the British ordinance, and it has been in place in Northeast for last so many years now. So, you know, the Constitution of India, which is based on liberal democratic traditions, does have exceptions in regions like Northeast. You know, it makes an exception. So, they emerge as zones of exception. So, do you think the Constitution also reflects that idea of India, which is, according to you,
I will respond to this question, starting from the first. The stand of space exceptions coined by Agamben is reflected. But let me tell you a bit about AFSPA. Let us not try to see AFSPA as the only Northeast separate, okay? Number one. AFSPA was throughout India from 1948 till 1957. Many are blind Buddhists. The ordinance was came into being to suppress good India movement in 1942. It becomes an act, and it was throughout India from 47 to 57. But then from 1958 onward, it's being imposed in Northeast. 93 to about, from 93 onwards for some years, it was in Chandigarh, then from 90 onwards it's in this thing. Point is, when I talk about AFSPA, my focus is more on the military aspect of the capitalist state. That how we engage it in, you know, structuralism as a forms of suppression of democratic rights. That's the point that I want to point out. With AFSPA or without AFSPA, you know, human rights violations by the state can take place. This is what is happening in this current Central Indian region. So unless we understand the all aspects of state terrorism deeply rooted in the manner of the capitalist structures, and we're going to fail completely. So some Northeastern activists really took it from a very sectarian perspective, and they see AFSPA as the only exceptional phenomenon. No, that's untrue. But yes, AFSPA has a symbolic significance, so we are targeting this significance. That's true. And need for regional approach, let me tell you, Northeast is a mosaic. I don't know where do we measure Northeast from, which part of the country. So, you know, I don't know, even the geographical location is very complex. And Northeast is very big, and it's not a homogeneous and tidy. And, you know, it's in a very distinct situation. You don't need a specific Northeast regional approach. You need a system that does justice to every individual in terms of distribution of services and in terms of you know, the proportionate development. That may also solve to some extent the problem. And India must incorporate the idea of federalism based on voluntary unionism. It must not try to make India into a prison house of nations and nationalities. That's the strong point that I want to focus. Number, because nations can come together and form alliance and live together as a multinational enterprise. Russia did it, they have experienced it. And also the European organizations have come together under the European Union. Some things that, you know, is not benefiting them, so we show pre-exist. So that should be not be seen as a fixed and tidy. It should be seen as something, you know, voluntarily constituted with the rights to self-determination, to determine their own future. without hurting or dominating others, right? That should be the approach. So you don't need to notice specific approach. You already have Lugis policy and notice specific approach and lots of destructions in the name of AFSPA. That's all right. We don't need exceptions. We only need friendship. We only require justice. That's it. Well, the idea of the neoliberalism, yes, and suffering of the people. See, neoliberalism is a terminological coinage, in fact. Capitalism adopts in different ways, in different circumstances. And somebody may call it something, or somebody may call it something, but the true fact remains that the strong collaborations between the rulers and the big financial powers and peoples, you know, the Indian capitalist forces. And neoliberalism also allows certain forms of semi-feudal remnants and tribalisms to exist because it really benefits them. Because they have to work on the basis of dividing people at various levels and various layers. So the point is like, you know, you have your own peoples being elected to the power, but these are, as I said, puppets who really control, who are dependent on the big forces for their own political and economic program. So there is no fundamental changes by adopting a different jargon or a different terminology. The systems of misrule, the system of and the structure of misgovernance continue to persist. So you may change the regime from the British to the Brown Sahibs, but the system of the exploitation and operations and underdevelopment initiated by the colonial forces has been largely continued. That may be the reason why some people rose in protest against you know, the so-called independence of the Nagas or the 26th Republic Day. It has to be continued because that's the way only, and that's the only way, you know, through which the Indian state could survive. That should be my brief response. And see, monotonous, what definition of nations and voluntary unionism. Let me tell you something. It was not simply a definition, it was a policy. And it was based on that policy that it was Soviet for the first time recognized right to self-determination of nations. And after Second World War, when the United Nations was formed, they were the big forces behind, which led to the declarations of the rights of the peoples and all. So what happened? When Russia was split into pieces, there was no bloodshed involved. So that historical right was recognized. And this is the only working definition. Many bourgeois theorists and postmodernist theorists have spoken lots on nationalism, but they have not been able to give a working definition on nations. That's the, this is a Stalinist definition which still remains persistent. And Indian state itself want to say that India is a nation because we have one language policy. Now they want to convert, the current regime want to convert Hindi into a national language, right? So they're working within the paradigms of these definitions. Although they are misrepresentations. So I think it's very much working still now. What is India? I am talking about Indian state. I'm not talking about the progressive Indian peoples and the past sons of the helpless beggars or whatever it is. So when I mentioned mystically India, I am referring to the Indian state. And when I say Indian state, it also includes the local puppet regimes. Out there in my own state.
We can go for second round of questions if there are any more. Yes, please.
Hi. My question is as a follow-up to the question that the fellow there asked regarding the definition of nationalism. So my argument here is that, you know, while subscribing to such definitions of nationalisms, are we not somehow limiting ourselves? Because if you sort of see, as some scholars would, the case of Nordis as, you know, to be in a state of exception, you know, it can be seen as a case of exception can we, withhold ourselves from defining our nationalisms or our sub-nationalisms, ethno-nationalisms, whatever we call it, and do we not, if we withhold that particular subscription to particular definitions and not define ourselves from the vocabulary of the other, and look at our movement as an entirely different one, as an exceptional case. Can we, imagine ourselves to have, a different discourse entirely? Because somewhere I found throughout your presentation, because you somehow alluded to very vaguely that the Meitei has somehow a little bit more claim. They somehow form an idea of a nation. Whereas the Kuki or the Naga lack that particular quality to be to see themselves as a nation, or to argue for a nation demand one more precisely. So are we missing something here? Can we withhold that particular subscription to one particular definition if we see ourselves as a case of exception here?
Well, it's very interesting. I have given definition of nation, not nationalism, number one, clarifications. All that I have given was definition of nations, but I have not defined what nationalism is. To define nationalism is very easy, love for nations, right? Love for nation is nationalism. But the point is, whether your love is really correspond to the objective reality or is this just an imagination? Anderson's talk about imagined communities, that's an imagination, not the ground reality. The Sikhs would have the Khalistan's imagination. They all live outside their state, and they are talking of Khalistan nationalisms from United States. Where will they fight war for liberation? They never come down. So where is the nation existing? It's an imaginary fiction. Now, I said, Meiteis in Manipur can be called a nation, but Manipur cannot be a nation. It's not a nation. I think you're following it. If you want to say that Nagas are a nation, then what about the Eastern Naga people's organizations saying that these peoples are not nations? And some peoples from the Nagas are saying that these are Kacha Nagas. So how do you explain it in the light of that? Psychological manifestations of oneness should come along with material foundations where linguistic, territory, and economic cohesion plays a very important and decisive role. Without that, it is unthinkable to imagine of nations. Only English-speaking peoples across the globe cannot form an English nation. Right? That's the reason why the 13 colonies in the United States demanded for a separate country. You might have the same language, but all the Meiteis together across the globe cannot form a Meitei nation because they are not geographically contiguous. The whole project of the Naga nationality forces in 1992 to 1996 was to flush out the Kukis so that they created a purely contiguous Naga areas because territory plays an important role. That's the reason why there was so much of escalation. Let's not go much deeper, but we can discuss outside it. But I am saying that Nagas are in the process of forming into a political community. They have coined a term called Naga. If you read the Simon Commission report, other memorandum to the Simon Commission, among the 7 tribes, Kuki was included. Kuki, who lives in Nagaland, was included as a Naga. But the many from the current Manipur were left out because till that point of time, there was no idea of federations coming up, emerging. It was a post-Second World War phenomenon which gradually got incredulized. So I am saying that there is a process of forming Naga into a political entity, which in the long process, if Nagamis would be able to become a lingua franca among the entire Naga-speaking people, and if by chance the alternative arrangements work out, and if they come together under one administrative area and there is economic development, which will unite people psychologically, then maybe in the future course of time, Naga nations may come into an objective reality. But that is not the condition in the present. That's what I am trying to say.